Hank, in buying these beautiful antiques and artifacts I see around your home, it occurred to me that you probably had to do some intense negotiating in buying these pieces of art. Were there any different approaches you used in, say, negotiating with a dealer and in negotiating with the individual artist?
Yes, particularly buying of antiques, where you're buying it, say, at an antique fair or antique market, rather than from the individual artist. There's a great deal of difference. What you first negotiate, very subtly, is you negotiate on the level of expertise you have about that particular art form, or that period, or that make, or that style, not on the price.
Mm-hmm.
And then when you both establish, that is, the person that's selling it, recognizes that you know what you're talking about, that you know the qualities, you know the flaws, then you start talking about the price. Negotiating with an artist, then it takes entirely different. It's the appreciation level. Since the artist not only, since the artist, as opposed to the dealer, doesn't have that type of ego in line, an artist does. So it's the appreciation. And so you negotiate that. And it requires a bit of stroking for the artist, so that the artist can win-win. When one win is sell his painting or work of art, win also in that he's selling it to somebody that truly appreciates it.
So in negotiating with the dealer and the artist, you focused on satisfying different needs.
Exactly. And that just brings us right back to negotiating, because negotiating is a process of satisfying needs. It's a basic problem that if you don't have needs at the negotiating table, you better create some, because you're going to have a hell of a time trying to negotiate. I guess if I could give one very simple way of describing negotiations, it would be to say that negotiating is a process by which you know what you want to get, what you're willing to give up, if anything, and when to do it. The difficulty lies is anticipating and understanding human behavior. That's the rub.
Negotiating is a process of satisfying needs. If you don't have needs at the negotiating table, you better create some. With those words, Hank Calero very succinctly pointed to an important characteristic of negotiations, and that is a negotiating relationship exists only because the two parties are interdependent. In other words, they need each other. Neither party can hope to satisfy its own needs and interest in the relationship without the consent and help of the other party. Now, there's also another need operating in all negotiations, and that's the need for independence, the desire to control our own lives without the imposition of constraints and without the threat that what we need and want, and which is often controlled by the other party, won't be taken away. So in every negotiation, each party has a need to make a variety of demands and offers to reach a settlement, but each party also has the option of leaving as a way of preserving its needs for being independent. And it's because of those conflicting needs between interdependence and independence that makes negotiating a delicate process of satisfying needs. To quote Hank again, negotiations is a process by which you know what you want to get, what you're willing to give up, and when to do it. The difficulty lies in anticipating and understanding human behavior. And that takes us back to needs, because our behavior is to a great extent conditioned or stimulated by our needs. And the greater our understanding of what the real needs are in a negotiation, the better our ability to know what we and the other party want to get and are willing to give up. As a way of illustrating this process of negotiating needs, and as a way of getting into some of the needs commonly found in negotiations, and how to identify those needs, I want to use an example of a negotiation which occurs every day at our jobs. As a member of an organization, we constantly negotiate what we think we should be contributing to the organization, and how we think we should be relating with other people at work, with what the organization expects and needs. When we take a position in an organization, it has associated with it a set of expectations and needs, what results we're required to get, how to go about getting those results, what we'll be rewarded or punished for, and how we should behave with superiors, peers, and subordinates. All these expectations make up the role to be performed by any person who occupies that position. Now, in addition to these formal role expectations, there are also those expectations and needs we bring to that role, what we want to accomplish, how hard we want to work, our needs for achievement and promotion, our needs for a sense of support and praise from other people, and our needs to exert influence in the organization. Let's go one step further, because in addition to the expectations set up by the organization and our own expectations, there are also those expectations each person we relate to in that organization has of us, which means that each subordinate, each peer and superior, sees us in their own way as to what our responsibilities are and how they want to be treated by us. Now, if our expectations are consistent with these other two sets of expectations, we have role consensus and everybody's happy. But with the complexity and rapid change found in most organizations, these expectations many, many times conflict, so that what we have constantly is role conflict. And much of our time in organizations is spent negotiating these role conflicts, or to put it another way, negotiating these different needs and expectations. Some examples of role conflicts which illustrate these different needs and expectations are, first of all, being overloaded with work. And that could include having inadequate time to meet our responsibilities or having to do the work of other people. Another example that many of us face is that what the organization expects of us quite often conflicts with our own personal values and needs. For example, spending time with our families versus the expectation of spending long hours on the job. Underutilization of our talents is another example of role conflict. We may feel capable of doing more and wanting to do more than what's being given to us as challenging work and opportunities for advancement. And a final example of role conflict are our needs to gain cooperation from others to accomplish our objectives, which may mean being dependent on many other people in the organization who have objectives which conflict with ours. So again, every day we spend on the job is a process of negotiating our needs with those of the people we work with. Now, what are some examples of these needs? In an organization or at the bargaining table, these needs are often economic. Salary increases, retirement and health benefits, the number of hours in a work week, how much interest to pay on a bank loan, or the selling price of a house or a company. How we identify these conflicting economic needs has already been touched on in previous cassettes and will also be covered further in the remainder of the program. But what often determines the economic bottom line in many cases are the negotiating of psychological needs. You will hear many examples from our panelists who, in negotiating labor management disputes, in buyer-seller negotiations, or in resolving organizational conflicts, paid attention to both these economic and psychological needs. They knew what the wage settlement range was in their industry, or they knew what the going prices were for what they were trying to buy, but they also knew what the other party needed psychologically. And their examples demonstrate how meeting these psychological needs often influenced the economic settlement. Hank Calero's example of negotiating for the art objects in his home pointed this out. With a dealer, he focused on making sure the dealer recognized Hank's expertise in understanding the quality of the merchandise and, in a sense, developed psychological credibility with the dealer before they started negotiating on the price. With the artist, on the other hand, Hank stressed the importance of meeting the artist's need for appreciation of his work as a first step in settling on a price. Now let's take a look more specifically at some of the psychological needs operating when we negotiate at work or at a bargaining table. One of the most useful descriptions of these psychological needs puts them into three categories. First, the need for achievement. second, the need for affiliation, and third, the need for power. I will describe each of these needs and give some examples of the behavior patterns we can look for to identify when these needs are important to people. But it's important to stress now that all of us have some element of these three needs in us, and depending on the situation, one or a combination of these needs may be operating in that situation. And that's where being sensitive to what's going on in the dynamics of negotiations becomes critical for identifying which needs are important at that point of time. First, let's examine the characteristics of those with a high need for achievement. Generally, they have a strong concern for getting a job done and doing it well. They like to accomplish something on their own, which is difficult to do and represents a test of their personal standards of excellence. More specifically, they like to be on their own and to take responsibility for their actions. They also set moderately difficult but realistic goals for themselves and like to take calculated risks, especially when they have control over the situation. In addition, they want and need concrete feedback on how they're doing, and they want to know if they've done a job well or poorly. Now, how are people with a high need for achievement motivated or influenced? First, they're more likely to be motivated through challenges to meet their own high standards. They're also more likely to be motivated when what's expected of them is clearly defined and when success or failure can be easily measured. And part of that is the recognition that comes from a success experience. So professional pride and admiration become important elements for motivating high-need achievers. They're also easier persuaded when they are presented with the facts. Facts, not feelings, are what's really important. So more often than not, using experts and using those holding legitimate authority, rather than using non-experts or friends, will result in convincing them. Another way of influencing them is assigning them tasks which involve a high degree of independence and working on their own rather than being a member or a leader of a team. One example of a negotiating situation where these motivators would work is in the negotiations that revolve around role conflicts, which I talked about earlier. If we're managing individuals with a high need for achievement, a good approach for negotiating these role conflicts would be to lay out clear roles and responsibilities for each person, with specific goals and objectives and measurable standards of performance. In addition, it would be a good idea to hold regular performance reviews to give them feedback and recognition. In negotiating with artists, scientists, technicians, or engineers, where professional pride is high on the list of motivators, it would also be important here to recognize the quality of their work as a way of gaining leverage. At a bargaining table, using facts and experts become important factors in persuading them. Also, if the opposing negotiator has a high need for achievement, making him work hard for a concession helps increase his satisfaction in winning that concession, which may be very important since maintaining an opponent's self-esteem is a critical element in successful negotiations. The second type of psychological need is the need for affiliation. People with a high need for affiliation have a strong concern for establishing friendship relationships. They have a desire to be liked and to be accepted. As a result, they pay close attention to the feelings of people. They go out of their way to develop a mutual understanding with people at the feeling level. But they also have a strong need themselves for social approval, in being seen as supportive and trusting, rather than being recognized for the quality of their work. In addition, they enjoy working with people, and they're more effective team players. So motivating, influencing, or controlling people with a high need for affiliation requires a great deal of energy developing a supportive relationship, which means being willing to spend the time listening to them and being understanding and empathetic. Influencing them also requires showing them that what you want will help them in getting social approval both from yourself and their friends and associates. And part of that is their desire to contribute to the growth of people. They like being seen as a developer of people. Finally, they enjoy working in a climate where they can work with other people who enjoy being open and candid, and who enjoy a group approach to sharing ideas and solving problems. The impact of meeting this need is often felt outside the bargaining table, where the trust between negotiators is developed in informal settings, where the negotiators feel each other out to determine whether or not they can trust each other and be open and deal with the sensitive issues in a climate of goodwill and conciliation. But affiliation can also be part of what's being negotiated. Quite often in the buying and selling of companies, the seller is concerned about the feelings of the people who have worked for him. As a result, the selling price isn't the most important factor at the bargaining table. He may be more interested in how the buyer will treat his employees and how his social standing in the community will be affected. The third basic psychological need is the need for power. People with a high need for power enjoy taking risks, where success would increase their leverage in making important decisions involving people and organizations. In many ways, they see work and life as a game, and they have a strong desire to be winners rather than losers. As a result, they enjoy challenging, competitive activities where they can prove themselves. In addition to having power, they spend a great deal of time and energy making sure other people see them as powerful, so they are constantly looking for ways to improve their public image and social prestige. To influence and motivate people with a high need for power involves meeting their desire to control the sources of power, whether those sources be information, money, or access to other influential people. Anything which would allow them to increase their range of social contacts would also be a motivator. This includes getting memberships in prestigious organizations, social clubs, charities, civic groups, or professional associations. Also, the symbols of power are motivators, whether that be the choice of an office, what furniture goes into that office, the way they dress, the cars they drive, and what public places they are seen in and with whom. Although these needs for achievement, affiliation, and power are invisible, their presence can be inferred from the behavior patterns associated with each need. What people do, the manager and negotiator can see. What they want, he can infer from what they say and do. So far, we've looked at several ways of increasing our awareness and sensitivity to these behavior patterns, including being more sensitive to the escalation of conflict, learning to identify the real differences during negotiations, and verbal and nonverbal clues for identifying what triggers conflict. At this point, let's take a look at a few other ways of increasing our awareness and sensitivity to these differences in needs. For example, looking at the background and present life experiences of a person can increase our insights into their needs and what's important to them. And this is important because each of us comes to a negotiation with a perceptual bias because of what we've learned as our own understanding of reality. And we can get a better glimpse at what this reality is through research on a person's social background, which includes where a person was born and raised, what schools he's attended, what he majored in, what professional positions and responsibilities he's held, and his religious and political preferences. Another indicator of people's values and needs are where they presently spend their time and money. What proportion of time is spent on the job compared to spending time with their families? How much time is spent on community activities? What voluntary and civic groups do they belong to? What are their recreational activities? How much time and money do they spend on their own personal and professional development? All of this information increases our understanding of their needs. In addition, it increases our understanding of their perceptual biases. Understanding of these perceptual biases is important because these factors are another cause of how they will act. Quite often, perceptual factors result in two negotiators seeing the same facts differently. One of the most useful ways of using this information prior to a negotiation is to role play or rehearse a negotiation. This would involve having a member of our bargaining team take the part of the person we'll actually be negotiating with. In acting out the negotiation, using the background research information we've gathered on the personality of the opposing negotiator and what his position will be on each issue can help us increase our empathy and gain a more objective view of the opposing negotiator and how they would react to our negotiating strategy. Role-playing can also be useful in clarifying our own perceptual filters and to gain a greater understanding of the assumptions we bring into a negotiation. Assumption making is something we all do, mostly unconsciously. All of us carry around assumptions about what is right or wrong and how people should react to our behavior and our viewpoints. Now, these assumptions help us to get through life without having to question and reason through every event in our lives. So basically, there's nothing wrong in making assumptions. However, they can cause us a great deal of trouble if our assumptions are off base, if they don't really conform to reality. And in negotiations, a great deal of time can be wasted if both parties don't test these assumptions. Our ability to test these assumptions and to see people and events as they really are is a critical negotiating skill. One of the best techniques for testing assumptions and also for increasing our understanding of the other party's needs is through the use of asking questions. These questions can be as simple as directly asking what the other party needs and what they expect as outcomes from the negotiation. For example, what are your objectives in this negotiation? What do you expect to accomplish? Questions can also be used to generate other types of information. Examples include the basic fact-finding questions of who, what, when, where, how, and why. What objections do you have to our position? Please show me how you arrived at that price. Questions can also be used to stimulate the other party to think through their own positions. Examples: have you thought about this? Or, we've experienced this problem in the past. Have you? Another useful type of question or statement can be used to directly check our assumptions about the other person's needs and positions. For example, I've made the assumption that you have the authority to make the final decisions in these negotiations. Or we can use hypothetical questions in order to evaluate the response and determine if our assumption is correct or not. Some examples of these hypothetical questions: suppose that I'm willing to offer you a 2-year contract. How would you react to that? What if we gave you a warranty on our product? In each case, we test the reaction and information generated from these questions to see if our assumptions are true or false. The problem with these basically common sense questions is that we often don't ask them, and that may be for a number of reasons. We may avoid asking questions because we feel it may reveal our ignorance or that we haven't been paying attention. Another reason is that we quite often prefer to talk and not to listen. And good questioning requires that we listen and not talk to keep track of the other person's reasoning, which is also an important source of identifying the right questions to ask. Another reason the right questions aren't often asked is that we don't spend enough time prior to the negotiation to develop them. We have to ask ourselves which of these obstacles limit our effectiveness in asking questions and take the necessary steps to overcome them. It's important to recognize that well-conceived questions that are concise, specific, and non-threatening, and which are used to get information and to clarify issues, rather than to take advantage of another negotiator, are a powerful tool for recognizing needs. Let's switch now to an introduction of how to negotiate differences once we've recognized them. In my interview with Dr. Schmidt, he describes 5 different strategies for negotiating conflict. At this point, let's return to that interview. One, are there a variety of strategies that a manager or negotiator can use to deal with different types and levels of conflict?
Okay, well, the way I think about that is first of all to recall that I'm dealing with both a competitive, an assertive dimension of conflict and a cooperative dimension. If it becomes clear after, and you know, we've cleared away all of the misunderstandings and it is now clear that you want something fundamentally different than I do, then there are about five major stances I can take toward this. And each one has an appropriate place. One possibility is just to avoid the confrontation. Not all conflicts have to be resolved. We can live with a lot of differences. Sometimes the issues aren't that important, or we don't have enough time and energy to resolve them, and better to let sleeping dogs lie. That's one posture. A second possibility is for me to go all out to win, to be as assertive, to use all of the power at my command so that I get what I want and you don't get what you want. And there are times when this is an appropriate strategy, when the issue is that critical. And I really believe that if you get what you want, it's going to be very destructive. And what I stand for is terribly important, so that we have a fundamental difference of interests and goals. Maybe that's the time for me to use all the power at my disposal. Mm-hmm. When I do that, I need to remember that I should be very clear in my own mind as to why I'm doing that, how important it is, what my goal is, and see that as sharply as possible. A third possibility is for me to go to the other extreme and to accommodate to you, to say, okay, on this one, let's do it your way. And there are times when that's appropriate, when, you know, sometimes I discover I'm wrong, or sometimes it is clear that it's more important to you than to get your way than it is for me to get my way. And so that's a third possibility. And we have a proverb about turning the other cheek and so on. A fourth possibility is to compromise. That is to each of us gives in somewhat. And this is appropriate sometimes when there's a very fixed resource. There's a certain amount of money in the budget. If you get more for your department, I get less for my department. And so we argue that one through, and neither of us gets fully what we want, but we don't lose everything. So half a loaf is better than none. And then sometimes it's possible to define the issues in ways that I can accept your goals and you can accept my goals. And instead of arguing about how to split up the pie, we try to think about how do we make the pie bigger so we can both get more of what we want. It's the collaborative kind of mode. Now, it seems to me all five of those have their place in somebody's repertory.
What you're suggesting, Warren, is that a manager or a negotiator, to be effective, must have the capabilities to move in either one of those five directions, depending on the situation.
That's right. And he should choose his strategy consciously and not rule any of those out. Like to some people, compromise becomes a dirty word. It sounds like weakness, like you have no principles and so on. But many problems, most problems, have to be solved by compromise. Mm. So you need to have all of these in your repertory, it seems to me. And in deciding which one of them to use, I find it useful to keep in mind really three criteria. First of all, to think about what the condition of the conflicting parties will be when the conflict is over. Mm-hmm. You know, if somebody is hurt too much or demeaned or so on, that's a factor to be weighed. You look at the realism of the decision or action that takes place. So that if you have a better idea than I have, and I somehow force us to go my way, we both lose, really. So you look at the quality of the decision or action. And the third thing is you look at what's going to happen to the relationship between the conflicting parties when the conflict is over. Because if that is damaged, particularly if they have to work together in the future, if that is going to be badly damaged, that has to be weighed into which method you select.
Can you overuse these styles or use them to your disadvantage?
Yeah. Yes. As a matter of fact, two of my colleagues, Ken Thomas and Ralph Kilman, have developed a little test, a little instrument, which helps people see to what extent they use one or the other of these styles. And if one finds himself fairly consistently avoiding conflict, mm-hmm. for example, it is useful to say, now why do I do that? Is it really because that was the appropriate way to handle that situation, or because I was afraid to assert myself, or what? So I think it is useful to monitor oneself in using these styles. And if you're overusing one, maybe it's appropriate, but at least ask why.
Let's review these strategies Warren has given us in more depth as a way of setting the stage for what will be covered in the following cassettes. In particular, I want to emphasize the strengths and limitations of each strategy. First, the avoiding strategy. Avoiding a conflict often makes sense as a strategy when the issues at stake aren't that important. There are also many situations when it's best to avoid immediately negotiating a conflict until we can clarify the nature of the differences, which may mean spending considerable time gathering the facts and allowing time for tempers to cool down. Avoiding conflict also makes sense when we have little chance of getting something out of a confrontation. Our leverage may be so minimal that any attempt to resolve it would only increase our frustration. The dangers of overusing the avoidance strategy include missing out on the positive benefits of conflict, especially its potential for clarifying where people stand and generating new ideas and approaches to a problem. Another danger of continually avoiding conflict is the psychological impact it can have on our belief in our ability to face up to difficult situations. Some people who continually avoid conflict situations tend to repress their emotional reactions. They either leave the conflict psychologically or physically, for example, by quitting a job. In many cases, they cannot face up to the stress involved in conflict or don't have the skills to negotiate conflict effectively. In the long run, avoiding conflicts too often can leave doubts and anxieties about meeting the same type of situations in the future. The second of the negotiating strategies Warren described is the competing or win-lose strategy. Going all out to win our objectives at the expense of the other party and without consideration of their needs. The win-lose strategy is useful when our vital interests are being threatened, or when we have certain values or principles which simply are non-negotiable. This strategy is also appropriate when emergency situations require quick and decisive action, and in some cases external constraints on one or both parties may prevent a compromise. For example, a negotiator's constituency may prohibit him from searching for a workable solution. A win-lose strategy may be the only alternative when the opposing party refuses to negotiate because their leverage base is far superior to ours, and a win-lose confrontation may be the only way we can get their attention. A win-lose confrontation may also be our only alternative when our attempts to seek a compromise are taken advantage of by the other party, especially by taking actions which are grossly unjust. The danger of overusing this strategy is that in the long run, negotiators damage their credibility and leverage. People can be threatened and coerced up to a point beyond which they either retaliate or break off the negotiating relationship. For managers and executives, overusing the win-lose strategy can inhibit subordinates from raising problems, presenting their own viewpoints, or taking initiative. The third strategy is accommodating, which means neglecting our own concerns and letting the other party achieve its objectives. The accommodating strategy is useful when the issue is much more important to the other person than to ourselves. It is also useful when we want to show our reasonableness or when a concession on our part helps build cooperation or because we want to set up the expectation that they will grant a concession on some other point. In some ways, the dysfunctional results from overusing this strategy are similar to continually avoiding conflict. In addition, accommodating too much can cause damage to our credibility and leverage as a negotiator when the other party starts taking advantage of us because of their belief in our vulnerability. For managers, an over-concern for the feelings and goodwill of subordinates to the neglect of getting the task done can ultimately result in ineffective performance. Compromising, the fourth negotiating strategy, often involves splitting the differences, exchanging concessions, or seeking a quick middle ground settlement. Compromising is appropriate when the two parties have conflicting interests, but reject fighting as too costly. They are saying, in effect, winning may not be everything, but losing is nothing. And as Warren pointed out, many negotiations deal with some type of fixed resource, which limits coming up with solutions which meet the needs of both parties. And under these conditions, compromises must be worked out. The major limitation of the compromise strategy is that it sets up a climate of game playing. Each side becomes accustomed to realizing that each negotiation will involve some compromise, so rather than searching for new ways of dealing with differences, the only game in town becomes manipulative moves and counter moves. Another limitation of compromising, with its emphasis on practicality, is that we can often lose sight of our principles, values, and long-term goals. Furthermore, an emphasis on compromising can lead to an avoidance of exploring conflict in depth and limit the search for creative solutions which can result in mutual benefit to both parties. Which brings us to the fifth negotiating strategy, collaboration, or negotiating for mutual gain. The emphasis in this strategy is on problem solving and generating creative solutions to the differences between the parties. Each party accepts the other's needs and interests as important, and they work together to achieve the best for each other, to fully satisfy the concerns of both parties. The parties are saying to each other, in effect, we'll accomplish more by pooling our resources and working together, and why should we fight when we can get all we want by collaborating? Again, negotiating for mutual gain rests on the assumption that a working through of differences may lead to a more creative solution than by compromising. There's a high level of tolerance for differences and a concern for building a climate of trust and openness between the parties as a basis for generating solutions to meet the needs of both parties. Negotiating for mutual gain is also useful when it's necessary to obtain a strong commitment from the other party to implement a settlement, and there's a way of developing a long-term cooperative relationship. The limitations of the mutual gain strategy include the large amounts of time and energy required. Problem solving requires building trust and openness and a willingness to deal with a high level of conflict and disagreement. And some issues are not amenable to problem solving, and some issues simply are not worth the effort. Another danger of this strategy is being taken advantage of by the other party. Without the required degree of trust and tolerance for differences, being frank and open inappropriately can be severely costly. To reemphasize Warren's point, these five strategies represent alternatives in negotiations. No one strategy is the best, and no one strategy is right or wrong. Negotiators need to use these strategies depending on the situation, and in many cases, each negotiation might require using a combination of these strategies. In the following cassettes, we will explore three of these strategies in depth: negotiating for mutual gain, negotiating for compromise settlements, and negotiating under win-lose conditions. We will focus on under what conditions to use these strategies and the tactics and skills for using the strategies effectively.